already know Duran can sing, but I can tell what y'all sing. You know, but four right here. Amen. Amen. If wouldn't nobody get up and start that devotional service, amen, he would get up. Praise God. I'm talking about four right here. What he would do. He would get up and he would start that devotional service. And if you let him hold on to that microphone long enough, he'll start preaching. Hallelujah. He'll start preaching and telling you about the goodness of God. Hallelujah. He believed in having church. He believed in the laying on of hands. He believed in praying. Hallelujah. He believed in prophecy. Hallelujah. He was a man of prosperity. Glory to God. That's what he stood on. The blessings of God. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you now, in the season that we're in right now, glory, it's time for blessings. We're in a season. We're in the season of Pentecost and Passover. Hallelujah. Begin to expect blessings and miracles. Hallelujah. I want to sing his favorite song. Amen. It's an old song. Let me tell y'all what it is so y'all can get ready for it. Amen. Roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. I want to go to heaven when I die to see old Jordan roll. And all the choir got to say is, roll, Jordan. Oh, Jordan. Roll, Jordan. I want to go to heaven when I die to see old Jordan. All right? And then in the band, we're going to break it down, y'all. We gonna rock the house. Don't drag it. Don't drag it. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm famous. I'm famous for telling you don't drag it. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. There's my beautiful niece over there. Hallelujah. Shania. That's Ford's daughter. Amen. I'm so happy to see her. Amen. I love these children. I love my family. That's what we stand. We stand for love. Yeah. Hallelujah. And I tell you, if anybody telling you not to love your children, you get them folks out your life. Get them out of your life right now. Because he stood for family and loving his children and loving the family. Hallelujah. That's what real men do. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Try to dig deep on this one. Y'all help me now. Roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. I wanna go to heaven when I die to see old Jordan roll. What?
like fires.
Later when his real brother, Duran, showed up. And
gonna tell y'all that Busting the Ram, but they ain't play with you, but them cats, boy, they would have you laughing, man. I'm telling you, boy. Y'all remember Van Damme, right? The dude they used to you know the guy that's famous for his name, not for his movies. But this was back in Van Damme prime. Me and the Ram, we were just chilling one day, and Buster came up out of nowhere. He told us, "Who wanna hear me talk like Van Damme?" And before I could answer, the Ram was like, "Me." Buster said, "What's called reddish lettuce?"
We want you to worship. We want you to praise. after the selection, you're going to hear the eulogy by their former mother, Pastor Willis. At this time, let's have our other selection. Amen.
Thank you.
money that Buster used to do every time that they would, we would come together. He said that he and the four boys, all of them, would gather up and go over to his other grandmother, deceased Mother Ford's house. And they must have been cutting up in church or doing something and got her distracted, and she made all of them get on their knees. She said, "Now you better not get up until you start speaking in tongues." Buster told me everybody was hollering out, "Brr, brr, la gee, la gee, la gee, la gee." But not get up until they spoke in tongues. Thank you.
That is not built or made by the
want to focus on that right there. And my thought that I just wanted to ponder on is that we have to prepare to move. We have to prepare to move. And in our communities, we find that there are houses, it's full of houses that people live in. And sometimes they get to a point where they decide it's time for me to move somewhere else. And people move for several reasons, and they move because they cannot afford to stay where they are. Sometimes the cost of living rises and it just gets too high. People move because they get tired of living in the same house. Some people move because the house is too small when they have a lot of children. But I know one of the main reasons people move is because a house can get too old and it can be run down and it can be damaged. And it gets in such bad shape that you just cannot stay there any longer, even when the landlord refuses to make repairs. Whatever the reason, when a person decides that it is time to move, they will begin to make preparations. They'll call Georgia Power and let them know, I need you to transfer my lights, my electricity. They'll call Georgia Natural Gas. They'll call, we used to call AT&T. We don't have to call the AT&T anymore. But we used to call AT&T to transfer the telephone. We call the Macon Water Authority to transfer the water. And then we will go to the post office and fill out a change of address form. And by doing all of this, we are preparing to move. People don't think very much about the human body as being a house. And that one day the spirit man inside of this house has got to move from this earthly house something just a minute here. The word house can imply that you're just staying there for a season, or that it's something that you're renting or leasing. You're not going to be there very long. While the word home can imply a more permanent dwelling place. And you can eventually own your home or inherit that home one day. So in our verses, Paul is letting us know that this world is not our home. Amen. And this body that we're living in is not our home. We are just passing through, and we're only going to stay here for a little while. But the question is, are we preparing to move? You see, there are reasons that we have to make plans for moving. There are signs that tell us every day that it's time to start making preparations to move from this old house, to move from this bodily house, just like we make plans to move out of these houses in our communities. You see, when we get those doctor bills and they get too high because we keep going to the doctor over and over and we complain, these bills get too high, I can't afford. Start preparing to move. When we sign up for the health and fitness gym,
go 6 days a week. And then cut down to 5 days a week. 3 days a week. 1 day a week and no day a week, because it's saying my knees just won't roll the wheels no more. Start preparing to move. We stress and deal with emotional strains that life's pressures can physically, mentally, and spiritually cause us to give up. We feel the need to give up. These are the signs that are telling us it's preparation time. When people mistreat us and they refuse to help us, those things can make us get tired. We get tired of dealing with the same old stuff and the same old issues that seem like they just won't go away. It's preparation time. Some people, we can say, live to get old. And they may soon realize quicker than some of the young people that it's time to make preparation to move on. But there are many others who overlook the signs of preparation. There is a story in the Bible of two men that is told to explain the need to get ready for the move, to prepare for the move. One man was rich. He had a large, beautiful, elegant home. He couldn't find nothing wrong with his house. I could tell you the story of the three little pigs if that would help you to understand. But I want to tell you about these two men in the Bible. This man had what he thought was a perfect house that was laid out immaculate in every way. So he told himself, I won't ever have to move out of my house because it's paid for. I'm rich, I own this house. And it's built out of bricks, so it's going to last forever. Well, there was another man that was poor. He was diseased and he was old. So his house was as old as he was. It was run down and ragged. The roof was leaking. His pipes had burst. He didn't even have any running water. No central heating air. He didn't even have a stove or refrigerator. You know why? Because he was a beggar. He was a beggar, and every day he would make his rounds begging, and he would eventually end up at the gates of the rich man's house. He would sit out there asking for some bread or some water, even dreaming that possibly one day the rich man would invite him in to sit by the fire. And it wasn't like the rich man didn't know him, because he was sitting at his gate every day. But this rich dude would say to the old man, man, gone. You got your own house. Leave me alone and stop coming down here. Why don't you stop hopping down here every day begging for stuff? You see, you can't hardly walk. It was true, the old man could barely walk, because the Bible said his body was all filled with sores. That sometimes even the dogs would lick his wounds. But one day the old man made his way down to the rich man's house, and he noticed that there was a piece of mail that had been dropped on the ground. And he recognized that mail, because he had gotten the same piece of mail delivered to his house. So when the rich man walked by, the old man reached out to try to given the mail, but the rich man snatched it and he threw it back on the ground and walked off and didn't pay any attention to what the mail was about. Now, some of you that are Bible scholars and churchgoers are kind of feeling where this story is stemming from, but I'm paraphrasing it for those that are young and restless. I'm paraphrasing it for the bold and the beautiful. Just let me say it for the generation that is unchurched and the generation X that don't believe that you too got to prepare to move. Realize why my son would be singing roll, German roll, but he was preparing to move. But allow me to continue for the benefit of getting this point across. The young man replied, "I ain't got time to be reading on junk mail." He said, "If it ain't the cash three lottery winning ticket, if it ain't a check from the IRS, moment." Old man looked up and he said, "Well, Lord, it's time for me to move on." He said, "I can't stand and stay here any longer." The old man began to walk, hopping back towards his house. To his house, he heard a noise that sounded like what some of us might call the Lazell wrecking crew. And even when he got closer, he saw that the demolition crew was there tearing his house down. But before he could even ask what's going on, a brand new Bentley pulled up and the door opened and a man said, "My He said, "God told me to come pick you up, there you go, and take you to your brand new house." Hallelujah. That's already been prepared for you. You see, Lazarus knew the Lord, and he paid attention to the signs. But a few days later, the young rich man noticed that he didn't see old Lazarus coming around his house begging him on. Well, he thought that was a good thing. But late, I'm going to say like other folks, look at your neighbor and say, "Late." Late one night. Matter of fact, it was that same night. The young man laid down to sleep in his house. Was laying down twiddling his thumb thinking he got it going on. He was having a party too, y'all. Had a few folks over, a few women over. Mercy, mercy. But while he was sleeping, he began to smell smoke. And when he began to get conscious, he said, "Well, I know I didn't leave nothing cooking on the stove. I know I put the fire out of the fireplace." He said, "My house is in perfect condition. So what is it?" What he did not know was that the demolition crew was there tearing his house down while he was sleeping. You see, there is something called the midnight demolition crew. That rezoning notice, that letter that he got, was a notice of rezoning plans that had been sent to everybody in that community.
He's an old man, Lazarus. The Bible said Lazarus was in his new house, which was in the bosom of Abraham. Well, that was a conversation that went on between these two men. And if I would continue to narrate this story right quick, it could have sounded something like this dialogue. Lazarus, the young man said, "Is that you?
where he's going. We got to go where he's going. And I just want to sing just a little bit of an old song that said, I want to be
sitting in the wondrous love of Jesus. send his mercy and his grace. In the mantle of bright and blessed, he will prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and we will shout the victory. Can we give our God the very best clap offering that we have in this sanctuary? To God, our Father, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, our commentary, and God, to all the men and women of the gospel, to his mother, can we give God praise for it? They would like to take this opportunity now to thank all of you for your acts of kindness that you've shown to them in their hour of bereavement. On the back of your programs, you'll find the most suitable and personal thanks. Please read it and take it to heart, letting you know, each of you, how appreciative they are for whatever part you played and whatever you did to assist them in their hour of bereavement. Thank you, and I'm sure the later more personal thanks will be sent to you in the very near days to come. Before we go any further, we do want to give God praise for Pastor Bale and the New Life Church for their hospitality tonight. To the family, on behalf of Bentley and Sons Funeral Home, we want to thank you for trusting your loved one to us. It is our prayer that God will grant you the serenity to accept the things that you cannot change, courage to change the things that you can, and wisdom to know the difference. I hold in my Bible and my possession an heirloom Bible and keepsake that we present to a loved one in memory of their loved one. And I'm going to ask his son, Daryl III, if he will stand at this time. And we're going to ask Pastor Maxwell if he would take this word of God and present it on our behalf.
Amen. Ministers, amen. And Mr. DeAndre Bennett.